What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In the previous videos of this series, we started by creating our first Spring Boot project and mentioned that if we're developing a long-term application, our environment might change. And Clean Architecture by Uncle Bob defines a set of guidelines that combines many code designs and principles which lead to a maintainable and testable code that takes into consideration all the uncertainties surrounding our project. Let me know in the comments below if you'd like a dedicated video in which we drill down this book in detail, but in a nutshell, its core idea is to divide our system into levels or layers based on the business value or context. The focus is to isolate the business logic and the domain from other parts of our application. The business does not care and should not care about our infrastructure details, for example. If the main components of our app request a certain object or send a specific request, let's say, and that object is retrieved or that request is processed, then we are good to go. You see, there are many layered architectures out there for you to check out, but the main idea they all relay is that outer layers will be much closer to our clients and to the business, and inner layers will be closer to our input, output, and storage devices, meaning that inner layers should never depend on outer ones, and your dependency arrow should always go inwards. With that said, let's try to reshape or reorganize our previous Spring Boot project to take into consideration this new design. And please, before we kick it off, please remember that code design is a very broad subject, and you may have a completely different project structure in mind than what we are about to cover. Nothing we'll see is set in stone. It's purely a mix of my own personal perspective backed by the Clean Architecture book. However, the main takeaway should be the same no matter what you do, and that is to decouple the client logic from the business logic from the infrastructure. And if you manage to do that, then we are aligned. Okay, since our previous project was a small one and I want to keep it simple in this first architecture video, I've decided to go with a three-layer design for now. We will come back in future videos to this app and further expand it. So, I am going to start by creating the skeleton of the design with empty classes or placeholders, and then we will go ahead and implement these classes. The first thing we're going to do is decouple the video entity we previously created from the rest of the application. If you recall, we were previously injecting the repository directly into the controller and were making use of a single entity across our whole application. This entity, the JPA entity, should sit in an infrastructure package dedicated to storing everything that has to do with external communications, such as reading from the DB in this example. The domain entity that will be used across our app will be like the JPA entity we have, minus a few unnecessary fields. This one will sit in its specific application or core layer of our design where the main business computations will take place. Every time we need to hop back and forth between these two layers or these two entities, a mapper will be used to map the domain entity to the JPA entity. Unlike our previous implementation, the repository fetching our entities from the database will not be injected directly into the controller, which is now sitting in our API layer. This repository will obviously belong to our infrastructure layer and will be injected into a service sitting in our core package. This service will take care of mapping our entities before calling the repository and retrieving the requested data from it. Now, that service deals with domain entities and therefore will be injected into the controller whose only responsibility now is making use of the business logic exposed to it via that service. A few validation or client checks can be added in the API layer, but no heavy business logic should be done here. This stuff belongs to the core or application layer of the design. In some references, people might aggregate the JPA entity with the mapper and use the mapper directly as the object that communicates with the database, for example. I prefer to clearly separate these classes, but that's just a matter of preference. If each layer and entity are decoupled from its counterparts, and if the dependency between these layers is going downwards only, then you have no problem. The simple design we just put together allowed us to decouple the client from the business from the database. Now, if we want, let's say, to change the JPA entity or drop the database and use another means of storage, all we must do is modify the infra part of our project. The other layers won't be impacted at all, and that's just one benefit of the simple layered design we just managed to put together. Okay, as an easy implementation of this project and for the sake of the video, we may have this video entity class being used by the repository to create, update, and delete our database. Then the domain JPA entities mapper class could be implemented as follows, allowing us to cherry-pick the attributes we want and/or apply additional transformations on them. The mapping will lead to the domain entity being used across our core layer and business logic. Additionally, this mapper along with the repository will be injected into the service we previously mentioned sitting in our application layer. This service will expose several functionalities to be consumed by our API layer. An example of some of these functionalities can be seen in front of you. This is by no means a complete implementation, just a concept to prove and draw the design together. Okay, the last step is to inject this service into the controller and consume the logic exposed. Now, an additional thing you can do is decouple this domain entity from the API model. One way to do that is to create a separate request and response model for each call, making their attributes, this and only this information, exposed to our clients. When a request is received or when a response needs to be constructed, they will be respectively mapped to and from the domain entity. By doing this, we decoupled business entities from API models and now have full control on what to expose to the users. Stay tuned to the next part of the series, in which we further expand on this logic, dive deeper into architecture and design, and see how we can make use of domain-driven design best practices to kind of enhance a few things, and or add a couple more I explicitly retained. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.